श्रीकृष्णा 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 गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुसाक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. There are two approaches to the reality. One is called as Shankar Vedanta. Vedanta spoken by Dr. Shankar Kumar. There is the second approach, which is called as Ishvara Advaitavada. And both of them are the same. They are not different. It is something like a glass filled half with milk. One person talks about that the glass is half filled. The same thing is seen by the other person, he says the glass is half empty. And they start fighting on this issue. And a person like me goes, lifts the glass, drinks the milk and gives the glass to them to wash. See, in one of my books, there is commentary on Amrutanubhava of Santa Ganeshwar. In the introduction, about 40 pages, we have brought this particular topic. How what Shankar Vedanta says and what Ishvara Advaitavada says is one and the same. But when we become obsessed with anything, then we try to prove that my brand is superior than your brand. Therefore, if we really want to walk the spiritual path, we should not get lost in a branding of our life. I go to so many places, they ask me, Swamiji, what is your sampradaya? Sampradaya means brand. So I say, look here, I don't have any brand, I am a generic product. Put any label and it's okay. So when I came here from Yogaville, there I was a yogi. I was in Charlottesville, there I was a bhogi, eating and enjoying. See, friends, we have to understand one basic principle about spiritual life. Spirituality is not gaining anything extra to become someone special. Being spiritual is being ordinary, not extraordinary. We understand we have to drop the extra fat, isn't it? But when it comes to spirituality, we want to add extra. And such extra persons in spirituality, their whole struggle is two ways. One, they want to prove something to somebody. The only problem is, they don't know what they want to prove and to whom. But they want to do that. See? And the second thing is, they try to justify whatever they do. These two things are the big barriers on the spiritual path. So, instead of getting lost in the brand value, we should straight away seek the truth. And in the process of seeking the truth, we must conclude in discovery of the truth as our essential nature. Then only our spiritual quest is complete. It is for this purpose, the Shiva Sutra is one of the most enchanting texts which attracted my mind when I was studying this Amrutanubhava. In Vedanta, we have heard Rute Jnananna Mukti. Without knowledge, there is no liberation. And in that text of Amruta Anubhav, there Santa Ganeshwar mentions knowledge is bondage. And that has shattered my all studies. I can't condemn Santa Ganeshwar. Then where is this knowledge is bondage? How it is possible? And in that I was once happened to be in Ganeshpuri in near Bombay. Santa Nityananda Swami's place. Swami Nityananda used to be there. And one lady came to meet me there and she said, "Swamiji, I don't know what to give you. Anything we give you, we pass on to somebody else. So I want to give you something which you will keep." Then she gave me a bunch of 3-4 books. And in that bunch, this Shiva Sutra was included. So when I was going back home in my friend's car, I just started seeing the pages, and the first I opened, this sutra came, Jnanam Bandha, knowledge is bondage. And I virtually jumped out of my skin. Come on, I found it. And thereafter, the intense study of this text has taken away all the wrong misgivings about the spiritual life. There is such a clarity in presentation. The path is called as upaya in this text. Upaya, upa means nearer, close. This is the meaning of upavasa. Upavasa doesn't mean fasting. Fasting, we eat fast food. That is not upavasa. Upavasa is sitting nearer to the divine, upavasa. Vasa is to be, to live. Vasdhatu. So, it's called upaya. Aya is a dhatu which tells to go. Aya gatau. So upaya means that which we stay, which takes us nearer to our essential nature. Upaya. And there are 4 of them. First is called as anupaya. Anupaya means it is not upaya at all. It happens. No logic, no reason. Why, how, when, where, don't know. Therefore, about this anupaya, nothing is spoken. Silence is the eloquence in this path. Then, second is the shambhavopaya, wherein importance is given to awareness. That was the first chapter we have studied. Then the next is the shaktopaya, where inquiry and control of mind, so that we are able to recognize, understand, know the truth. That is shaktopaya. What can be parallel to in Vedanta as the jnana marga, path of knowledge or inquiry. And the third one is, the fourth one is the anvopaya. Anvopaya means the one who has considered himself to be a limited being. He wants to struggle and find out what is the reality. So today onwards, we study the last one, Anvopaya, in the third chapter of this Shiva Sutra. Before we go, I'll give some basic idea about life. Our life has got 3 components. One is the world where we live. Second is the experiences that we have about this world. And third is the one who is experiencing these experiences. 3 things. So, the world includes the practice of dharma. Dharma Shastra is at the level when we take this world as real. Therefore, we are told, do good, be good, don't hurt others, help everybody. Respect elders, satyam vada, dharmam chara, swadhyaya, anma, pramadaha, acharyaya, dhanam, priyamarutya, prajadantum, vyavachetsihi, satyanna, pramaditavyam, dharmanna, pramaditavyam. This is the dharma shastra. At the understanding that this world is real. This world also includes our body, gross body. So, while dealing with the world, Dharma Shastra. While dealing with our own body, Yoga Shastra. See, these 2 things should be clear. With the world, dealing Dharma Shastra. With our own body, dealing Yoga Shastra. Then the second component of our life is experience. And what is our experience? We are all struggling unsuccessfully to fulfill our desires. Right from childhood till date, what we have done? Trying to fulfill the desires. Not knowing or not recognizing, we fulfill one desire, second is standing in the queue. You fulfill the second desire, third is standing in the queue. It has no end. And yet we have not understood that fulfillment of the desires never leads to fulfillment in life. Now such us, what we do then? Then again, like the world and the body, in the same manner, God. So such people follow the path of devotion. And what is devotion? Devotion is nothing but a simple agreement between you and God. Oh God, you have got infinite powers, no desire, and I have got infinite desires, no power. So let us have an MOU, and my desires and your power can be properly invested, and both are benefited. Win-win situation. You get a devotee, I get my desires fulfilled. Devotion. Nobody goes to the temple or devotion for the sake of God. We make that poor God as the means and the worldly achievements as the goal. See? That is devotion. And at the subjective level, it is awakening of the Kundalini. God's energy, God's power, to invoke Him outside, and the same God's power, energy, Shakti, invoke subjectively is the path of Kundalini awakening. Make it clear. Outside dharma, yoga. Experience level, devotion and awakening of the Kundalini. See? Now the third thing, third component is the experiencer. Now the experiencer is not two. Like in dharma, world and the body, in devotion, God and the Kundalini. But when it comes to the experiencer, now the experiencer is investigated. Kastvam koham kutamayataha kame janane kometataha. See friends, every confusion, every problem in our life is the God's grace. This principle you understand please. Most important principle. See, I cannot leave Bhagavad Gita when I think. And the best thing I like in Bhagavad Gita is the first chapter. Many people bypass it, but that is the foundation of Bhagavad Gita. Imagine, if there was no confusion created by Bhagavan Krishna in the mind of Arjuna, by bringing the chariot in front of Dronacharya, Bhishmacharya, and telling him you have to fight with your own nears and dears. So confusion is added. See? So what is that confusion, doubt? That confusion or the problems of our life, they are like the attenuated live vaccines. What the vaccines do? Vaccines are nothing but purposefully introduce foreign body in our system so that it produces the required quantity of antibodies and protects us from the impact of the possible disease. Is it not? Exactly the same way. When everything is going goody, 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 who thinks about God? See, take a simple example. Your dreams. When your dreams are going very well, no dream breaks. But in the same dream, when some accident happens, you fall somewhere and then suddenly the dream breaks. So to come out of the illusion of the dream, you require an illusory accident. In the same manner, to come out of this waking dream, we require some kind of illusory accident. And then we start thinking, who am I? What is this world? Whence am I? What for I am? See? And then be attentive. Then a seeker is born. When a seeker is born, He is no more interested in the world. He is no more interested in the body. He is no more interested in the God. He is no more interested in the Kundalini. No, his interest is whence I am. Who is this I? And for that, now he starts working on his mind. When we start working on our mind, then alone a seeker is born. Till such time we work on the world, we work on the body, we work on God, we work on Kundalini, we are far away from the spiritual path. It is religious path, it's not spiritual path. And it is necessary, it is not condemned, it is necessary. Like when we go to the our education, we go earlier in the KG1, KG2, primary, it's all necessary. But we can't continue to be in KG1 throughout our life. We have to graduate. And the funniest thing in graduation in America is that useless child KG1, KG2, he's graduated. And my other son is in undergraduate, looking. Have you ever thought about it? This is America. Parkway, they drive the car, and driveway, they park the car. So, we want to find out who is this I. And when we take up this, we entered the third chapter of this beautiful text, Shiva Sutra. Now, in the first chapter, the self was defined as Chaitanya Atma. Then, second, it was a Chittam Atma. Now, here it is said, in the third one, it is said, Chittam Atma. Now, Atma, the self, is the mind. First step to understand. Everything happens only to the mind. Nothing happens to body. Nothing happens to the absolute self. First principle to understand, recognize. This I have learned many years before. Once somewhere in Bombay, some people came and did namaskar after my lecture, and there was one doctor among them. When he did namaskar to my feet, he said, Swamiji, what is this growing on your big toe? Something was growing, red kind of thing, you know, like a berry, small thing was growing. He said, Swamiji, what is this happening? I said, this is wisdom toe. I don't know what it is. He said, no, don't make joke, this is not good, you have to remove it. I said, okay, I'll remove it. He said, no, I am a doctor, I can do it. I said, okay. So right from there I went to his clinic. And he gave me local anesthesia in my big toe. And after 10-15 minutes he just started playing with it. And he said, how do you feel? I said, comfortable, very nice. No. Are you feeling on your toe? I said, which toe? Because there was nothing, it was anesthesia was complete locally. Thereafter, he said, you can watch now. And I was watching my toe. He took the scalpel, put right into it, and took it out the whole thing. And he showed me, see, it has come out completely. No roots are left. So you are very lucky, now it won't spread in your feet. That day, instead of looking at that, my mind was somewhere else. I said, come on, I saw he was cutting my toe, but nothing happened to me. What is the reason? The reason is my toe was under chemical meditation. So where are the experiences happening? Everything happens only in the mind. See, friends, there is no life in absolute consciousness. There is no life in absolute matter. When consciousness and matter, they unite, then the life is a manifestation. And the manifestation of the life begins by expression as mind. Then that mind comes out of the eyes, becomes the vision. The same mind comes out of the ear, becomes the hearing ability. The same mind comes out of the nose, becomes poking ability. We poke our nose everywhere now. Pokeability. mind is behind. In this manner, everything, Atma Chittam. So when I say I, here I means the jiva, the soul, the mind. See? Atma Chittam. Now in this what happens? That this is called as Anvopai, and is Anvopai, the Anu, these are the three words used in our this science. You must have heard in Kathmandu there is a temple, Pashupati Nath. That Pashu is Anu, Pati is Ishwar, Nath is Paramatma. In the language of Vedanta or Bhagavad Gita, Pashu is Jiva, Pati is Ishvara, and Purushottama is Paramatma. Yasmat charamati toham aksharadapichottamaha atosmi loke vedecha prathita purushottamaha. So Bhagavan says there, dvau imo purushau loke ksharascha akshara evacha ksharas sarvani bhutani kutasto kshara ucchate. So the matter aspect is the kshara purusha, the kutastha, the living being in every body is the jiva, he is the akshara purusha, and paramatma purushottama is the one which is expressing through the body as life is Purushottama. See? Therefore, yasmat ksharamati toham aksharad abhichottamaha. I am beyond the matter and expression of me in the matter. Aksharad abhichottamaha. Ataha asmi loke vedecha. Therefore, in the world and in the scripture, I am referred as Purushottamaha. Yo mam evam asammudaha janati purushottamam. He who is no more deluded, in this manner he understands the meaning of Purushottama is the absolute reality, although functioning in and through the totality, yet beyond this totality, beyond this relativity. He who thus knows me, etat buddhva buddhivan syat kritakritascha bharata. Unless we recognize our divinity, life will never attain fulfillment in life. See, friends. So, this Atma, Chittam, Jiva is expression of Paramatma through the limitations of the Panchakoshas. That is the meaning of Anu or the Pashu. Pashu means Pashyati iti Pashu, na Thinkati. Whatever we see, I want, I don't like, I like. There is no logic, there is nothing. If you think, you know, for our likes and dislikes, which is guiding our whole life, the likes and dislikes have no logic, no reason. Somebody likes green color, somebody likes red color. What is the logic behind it? The other day I went somewhere, Swamiji, how do you like this color? I said, colors are never liked. Which is a good color? Color is good or bad or what? Our whole life is guided by these likes and dislikes, which has no meaning. And therefore, Pashyati iti Pashu, this Pashu is Anu. In Jain philosophy, they use the word Anu. Anu. One of my friend, his son's name is Anu. But it is Anu, Na. It is not Na, not Anu. It is Anu. Okay. Now, asya chitta swarupasya anuatmanaha. Now, this jiva, the anu, who is of the nature of the mind or the chitta, what is his? Jnanam bandaha. For him, knowledge is the bondage. See. Now, be attentive. Jiva or the soul, or this anu, or the pashu, is expressing through the limitations of his sense organs and mind. As a result, he is obsessed with the idea, whatever I can see, that alone I believe. Whatever I see, that alone is the ultimate. There is nothing beyond it. Whatever I can hear, that alone is the truth. It is not beyond it. So what is happening is, the limitations of our sense organs, the limitations of our mind, the limitations of our intellect is conditioning our experience. And that conditioned experience is mistaken as the ultimate experience. And therefore, people ask the question, have you seen God? So what is their understanding? God is an object to be seen by the eyes. See. Have you felt God? Is it garmi or thandi or what? Felt garam garmi. No. See. Have you understood God? Is God a concept? See. Once in Pittsburgh, many years before, after my talk, the professor of philosophy, he said, Mr. Swami, you presented the concepts very well. I said, sir, I am sorry to disagree with you. I did not present concepts. You are a professor is a concept. You are successful is a concept. But you are is not a concept. It's a reality. Therefore, one has to drop all these things. But we get obsessed by this and that becomes the jnanam bandha. Therefore, sukha dukha moha maya dva avasayadi vritti rupam tat uchita bheda bhava bhavanatmakam yat jnanam tat bandha. So this knowledge creates divisions, creates liking and dislikings, creates evaluation, etc. And that knowledge is creating the real bondage. See, friends. This you can see day-to-day life. You don't have to go to Himalayas and spoil that. See? When it is my child, the expressions are different. When it is somebody else's child, expressions are different. See, friends. Now, still subjective. When somebody is talking about his experiences about something, we don't want to listen to that. We want to talk about our experiences because where I is not, we are not interested. See? Today, when I was taking tea in the evening, this sweet girl came from her job. So I asked her, hey, what kind of job it is? Do you have to give jhadu or clean the utensils? Then she was telling something she has to do in her thing, something about the mice and all that. So, the topic is over. But what interest will I get? Because I am not there. Then I will get interest in that where I was there. Then instead of listening to her experiences, I will start my own story. You know, once I went there and this thing happened, that thing happened, nobody asked me. See, friends, this is the way jnanam bandha. And this is how ego is developed. Ego is nothing but a mule carrying the burden of total past experiences of the possessions and relations. Try not to bring your past in the present. You have nothing to talk. All that we talk to others is only past. And total of the total past is not the completeness. Infinite is not equal to the summation of the finite. Ocean is not the summation of all the waves. It is much more than that. Space is not the summation of the 10 directions. Space is much more than that. See, man is not the summation of the father, husband and the wife. And the father, husband and the son. The same man. He is son to his father, husband to his wife, and father to his son. Is that man only the summation of the three? He is much more than that. Atyatishtat dashangulam, Purusha Sukta tells. But we get caught up in that. And our whole life is only wriggling around that small well like a frog in the well. He cannot think beyond it. That is jnanam bandha. That is the bondage. And therefore, all the time we want to talk continuously only about ourselves. And the wise people know this. And therefore, they know, yehi sansparshaja bhoga, dukkha yodaya evate, adyantavanta kaunteyana teshuramate buddha. Wise people know, these worldly experiences, worldly enchantment, is only temporary. It cannot give you permanent joy. And such people, such jivas, such souls, now they have taken to the real spiritual path because now they have withdrawn from the world and they are now working on their mind. They are no more holding on to the perception through the senses and the mind as the ultimate knowledge. Kaladinam tatvana aviveko maya. Now the question comes, how this jiva, who is of the nature of the knowledge, how come he is not able to experience his infinite self? The question is like this. If the light in the bulb is the expression of electricity, why this light which is able to illuminate everything, why in that light we cannot see the electricity? See? The mind, the eyes can see everything in this world, why the eyes are not able to see themselves? Why the eyes are not able to see the mind? See, friends, because mind is expressing through the structural eye as vision. So how can the mind see the source? Not possible. And therefore, what is the reason? Here the teacher says, kaladinam tatvanam aviveko maya. It is because of the maya. Now this maya we have to understand. This maya is referred in this scripture in three ways. There are three types of maya. One is the maya shakti, the divine infinite potentiality of the Lord. See, in Vivek Chudamani, Bhagavan Shankaracharya says, avyakta namni paramesha shakti. This avyakta namni, of the name of avyakta, unmanifest, that is the divine potentiality. And this, because of this potentiality alone, the Paramatma appears to have become many. So that is the Maya Shakti, Paramatma's, Bhagavan's potentiality. The second is the Maya Tattva. Maya Tattva is, it is the same principle happening everywhere. Like, you know, electrical energy flowing through any bulb expresses only as light. It is a principle, you can't change it. The one is the potentiality. Second is the expression of the potentiality in the similar condition will be same. Therefore, whether it is a human being or animal or any living being, the principle of hunger, thirst, anger, greed, security, sleep, eating, procreation is common. It is not different. It is not that the food which satiates the hunger of a rich man is superior than the food that satiates the hunger of a bird eating the dead carcass. It is the same. That is the Maya Tattva. Get it very clear. So one is Maya Shakti, infinite potentiality of the Lord. Second is Maya Tattva. Expression of that Maya Tattva is common in the creation. Those who are able to recognize this Maya Tattva, they attain sarvatmyanubhuti. They are able to recognize their identity with the totality. And therefore in Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan Krishna says, Atmaupammena sarvatra samam pasyati yorjuna, sukham va yadi va dukkham sa yogi paramo mataha. He who is able to recognize joy in the happiness of others, and who is able to extend a helping hand those who are suffering, he alone has discovered identity with the totality. That is the Maya Tattva. So one is Maya Shakti, Bhagavan's potentiality. Second is Maya Tattva, expression. And the third is the Maya Granthi. See, the third one is referred here as. Granthi means a knot. Knot means a knot, that which doesn't exist. And yet it is very knotty. One day, one sweet little girl, maybe about 7-8 years, I was staying with them. She came, Swamiji, what are you doing? I said, no, nothing, I am just playing with the laptop. I want to ask you something. I said, ask. When the world is created and where from the world begins? So I looked at her, I asked her, who asked you to ask me this question? Mummy. So I told her mother, I said, Mama, why don't you ask me directly? Swami, I am afraid of you, I don't know. See, I told her, look here, this world is created the moment we are identified with the gross body. Get this point across. This is my regular experience. This morning I woke up in Madhav's house. Then I finished everything. I came in the afternoon in Aparna's house. And I do only two things, eat and sleep. Rest of the things happen. So I had my nice food and I slept. And when I slept, again I know where I am. See? Because the world begins the moment you are identified with the body. So don't ask this question. So many years before, 23 trillion light years before the Prithvi, the earth was created. We can't think beyond 100, 200 years. And they tell about it in a trillion years. Nothing happens. See? It is not, our human mind cannot comprehend beyond a particular limit. It can comprehend only limited things. See? And when you try to comprehend, it leads to illusion. Like this, space cannot be seen by the eyes. But eyes want to see. The net result is optical illusion. And we say that the space is blue. So all that we are seeing is only an optical illusion through the limitations of the sense organs. So Maya Granthi is that because of which the identification with the body happens. And then I am man, I am woman, I am young, I am old, I am beautiful, I am awful. Then the identification happens with the prana. Then I am hungry, I am thirsty. Then identification happens with the mind. I am happy, I am unhappy. Then identification happens with the intellect. I am self-made man, like a amoeba. By binary fission I am born. See? And then I am the Baba, happy-go-lucky. See, friends. Identification with anything is the beginning of this world. Be attentive. Therefore, what will be the spiritual practice? Only one. Disidentification from the body. These two things, if you catch, you are really step on the right path. First is, anything that will help us discard body identification, that is the spiritual path. After this is traded or walked for a sufficient time, then the second is the notion that I am a soul in this body. Two things. Unless these two things are transcended, you may do anything. Like Bhagavan Shankara says, Kurute Ganga Sagara Gamanam Vrata Paripalanam Athava Danam Jnana Vihina Sarvamatena Bhajatina Muktim Janma Shatena. You may keep on doing goody 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 thing, nothing going to help you. See, friends. Therefore, this Maya Granthi is the one wherein we are caught up in this body and mind identification. So this is what he said. This Maya is Kaladinam Tattvanam Aviveko Maya. So one is not able to recognize and discriminate between Kaladinam Tattvanam. We have seen in the first chapter, there are five tattvas. Kala, Vidya, Raga, Kala, Niyati. Kala means an aspect. Like Paramatma is infinite, but we have created aspects. Jiva, Jagat, Ishwara. Like moon is 17th and moon is 1. On the 17th one moon, we superimpose 15 Prathama, Dvitiya, Chaturthi, Panchami, Purnima and Amavasya, 16. On whom? On the moon. Moon is only 1. But we have made 16 out of that moon in the same manner. Paramatma is but 1. But we have made so many fractions. This is the one of the Kanchuka of the Maya. Kala, then Vidya, being omniscient, we continue to be illiterate, ignorant about everything. Vidya, then the third is Raga. Raga is attachment or desire because of sense of incompleteness. And then Kala, we are beyond the influence of time, but we are all the time afraid of time. I don't know, one person asked me in Bombay, Swamiji, last few days I am having a fear about death. I said, see, you ask your question, one by one we'll sort out. First, fear about death, I guarantee you will die. Next question. Fear means what? Option, whether I will die or I will not die. So once you know you are going to die, relax. If you have a doubt whether you will die or not, then you can worry. How simple it is? See, friends, nobody suffers because of death. People suffer because of the fear of death. Suppose I die here, nothing will happen to me. You will have a problem. Oh God, how to dispose of this fear? We have not made preparations for this. All preparations were made, but this we forgot. See, friends, when these big ministers and country heads go from one country to another country, they make all arrangements. Their blood group is known, blood is made available, vehicles, if they die, how to dispose of, everything is made ready, you know. Anything can happen. So, this Kala, impact of time, and Niyati is what is due to come to us, nobody can stop it. Accept it as it is. Right in the presence of Bhagavan Krishna, Arjuna's son was killed. Right on the battlefield. What Krishna did? When Bhagavan Krishna was there, Draupadi's five sons were slaughtered by Ashwatthama. See, friends, all that is due is bound to be. The only thing is be prepared. We accept the things as they are. When we thus lead, then only this maya will not impact us. So, kaladinam tattvanam avivekaha maya. But we imagine, you know, this is one of the questions which was asked by the yaksha to Yudhishthir. One of the questions was this: what is the most surprising thing in this world? Taj Mahal? Is it too? Not Taj Mahal. Then he said, people take the dead bodies to burn on the cremation, but they never think that they are going to die one day. And they start living equally as if they are born to be here permanently. The most wonder of wonders. Therefore, atascha etat prashamaya, then how do we get rid of the impact of this maya, the body identification, the impact of the limitations of the panchakoshas? How do we get rid of this? Sharire samharaha kalanam. See? We have to dissolve all the three bodies in its own source. Samhara means destruction, dissolving. See, friends, Kathopanishad. There, the teacher takes this laya prakriya. Yachedvang manasi prajnaha. Tadyachet jnana atmani, jnana atmani mahati niyachet, tadyachet shante atmani. Yachet vang manasi prajnaha. Vang means speech, means the gross world. Dissolve the gross world in the mind. How to dissolve the world in the mind? Keep your mouth shut. See this experience. At this moment, you are neither man nor woman, neither in America nor in India. You just are. Nothing is done. It is as simple and as effortless as it is for the wife to become a woman. Woman can become a wife. Wife can never become a woman. Reason being, she is already a woman. We don't have to become divine. See, friend. So, sharire samharaha kalanam. Yachet vang manasi pradnya, tad yachet jnana atmani. Now, dissolve this mind in the intellect. Dissolving the mind in the intellect means learn to remain indifferent to anything that is perceived through the mind. I am not telling you that a thing called as witnessing consciousness, sakshi bhav. I have struggled with that for years and I came to a conclusion, is useless. Don't get into that sakshi bhav. Contrary to that, learn to be indifferent. When I say, I am sakshi to you all, that means my attention is on you. But when I am indifferent to you all, attention is not on you. How to do that? As you are listening to lecture, in the same manner, listen the worldly things. Now here we tell you, you are Brahman. Ah, Swamiji, mazak kar rahe. Okay, you are a fool. Why do you call me fool? See? Learn to remain indifferent. Then you have come to the intellect. And that individual intellect, mati niyachet. Dissolve that individual intellect in the total intellect. Total intellect is God's will. Here devotion begins. Jehi vidhi rakhe ram, tehi vidhi rahe. This process of dissolving is like an ice cube falls in the ocean. For some time it will keep on dancing with the waves, ups and downs. And after some time it will be dissolved in the ocean. And in that process of dissolving there will be no noise. There will be no efforts. What the ice has done, let go. And what it lets go? Name and form. So, mind is consciousness. Like ice is waters. But when name and form is added, consciousness is called as mind. When name and form is dropped from the mind, it is consciousness. This world is asti bhati priya nama rupa iti pancha amshakam adyatrayam brahma rupam jagad rupam tato dvayam. Asti bhati priya satchidananda and nama rupa. Out of this five, nama rupa, name and form is the world and asti bhati priya is paramatma. So wherever name and forms are dissolved, paramatma manifests. And what is our life? Prana jai par bachana na jai. That is why in comparison to Ramayana and Rama, I like Krishna. He is practical. He doesn't make issue out of anything. He will say, I will not take any shastra on the battlefield. And he takes. Well, why you have taken? I have taken. Kya karna hai, kar lo. See? That joy. He is abiding in the truth. So, sharire samharaha kalanam. Therefore, one can just start withdrawing. This is a very deep process. And you can do it any number of time in a day. One small technique I'll tell you. Colors and forms are nothing but grossified vision. Vision is subtle, without color and without form. Like water is subtle, without color and without form. When it classified as ice, it has a form and a color. White. In the same manner, vision is without color and form. When it classified, it is called as the objects. Ruparanga. Then mind is without color and form, without vision or no vision, but the vision is classified mind. Similarly, consciousness is the absolute and mind is classified consciousness. Journey is from the gross to the subtle. This is what is meant by Sharire Samharaha Kaladinam. Thereafter, Evam Dhyanakhyam Anamam Upayam Pradarsha Tad Eka Yoga Kshiman Pranayam Dharana Pratyara Samadhin Pradarshayati. Now, this technique which we are just now told will be also now in the form of Dharana Dhyan Samadhi, and therefore it is said Nadi Samhara Bhuta Jaya Bhuta Kaivalya Bhuta Prutaktvani. So, when the prana is dissolved in the Sushumna Nadi, be attentive. Sushumna Nadi is not the third one. Most of the people understand there are two tubes and there is one center tube. So in the two tube, the air comes and goes in the center one. No, it is not that. See, Nasabhyantara Charinam, Bhagavad Gita says, when our both the channels of energy flow, Ida and Pingala, left and right, when they are perfectly balanced, that 100% balance of Ida Pingala, that balance is called as Sushumna Nadi. It is not the third one. But normally people will go and say, acha, isko andar dal, isko andar dal, ye to gayi, ye nahi ja rahi. No. Only perfect balance. Samatvam yoga uchyate. This is what whole Bhagavad Gita is talking about. Maintain the equanimity. So when the equanimity is maintained, you start conquering your mind. You start conquering your interactions. Earlier, our way, our lifestyle was different. Now it is totally different. Situations may be the same, but our interaction will be different. Like initially, when a person doesn't know driving car perfectly well, like, you know, once I told in my talks, one lady in Bombay told Swami, now I have learned driving, anywhere you have to go, he tell me. I said, okay, let's go, I have to go now only. We have to go to Bhindi Bazaar. And we came from Andheri side, we came to Dadar in the center part. And there she stopped the car. I said, why you stop? We have to go ahead. He said, no, Swami, a very good parking place I got. I said, but because there is a parking place, you don't have to park the car. We have to reach the destination. No, 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 we'll take a taxi and go. I said, what is this funny thing? Why? Swamiji, in that Bhindi Bazaar, I tell you, I cannot reverse the car. You know? And therefore, I will not be able to parallel park it, you know. See? So, it is a difficult situation initially, but once you become expert, then there is no problem. In the same manner, initially we feel difficult how to change ourselves, you know. No, we have to change our habits. Two aspects of our personality. One is Swarupa, second is Swabhava. Swarupa is essential nature. Swabhava is acquired nature. Acquired nature, if we have acquired, we have to stop that. Nobody is born with a cigarette in the mouth and lighter in the hand. We have acquired it, then we have to stop it. See, friends. Therefore, in this manner, Nadi Samhara Bhuta Jayaha, thereafter, one is able to conquer the impact of the Panchamahabhutas. See, friends. In Yoga Shastra, there are many, in the third chapter, it is called as Vibhuti Pad. After the seeker has attained Sayama, Bhagavad Gita uses this word, Yanisha Sarva Bhutanam Tasyam Jagrati Sayami. So when a person has acquired perfect Sayam, Sayam means control of mind with reference to time, space and object. So that Sayamit mind, when it is, let us take for example, when the Sayama is done on the Kantakupa or the esophagus, he conquers hunger and thirst. Such a person will never suffer from the limitations of hunger and thirst. So these are the various vibhutis that can come forward. So here also, bhuta kaivalya, when we thus are able to practice this sadhana, one attains bhuta kaivalya, the ability to of the mind to withdraw from these worldly things freely, without any effort. See, many of us are not even able to go to sleep when we land on the bed. It takes, you know, a dosha treatment. First we sleep on the back, then we go on the left side. That dosha is one palti. Then also it is not properly cooked, the other palti. Then we come to the right side. And then ultimately we come on the bhujangasana, on the stomach. And then farrar they start sleeping. We can't even sleep in one go. What can we achieve in life? One person asked me this question, Swamiji, how do you define health? I said, the one who can sleep and eat properly is healthy. For us, whenever you start taking food, immediately, calories, are Ram Ram, daba ke khao, mauj mein raho. Instead of eating good food, these people are lost only in their useless thing called as calories. There is no meaning in that calorie. Similarly, one of the name of Arjuna was Gudakesha. Gudakesha means Gudakayaha Ishaha Gudakeshaha, the one who has conquered his sleep. Wow, that means me, I can sleep anywhere, anytime. No, that means he can wake up. Oh, that is these two things. The ability to sleep without efforts, the ability to take food and digest normally is called as the real health of the man. All other things, if you can lift into the huge thing, then you are a coolie, not a healthy person. Nadi samara, bhutaya, bhuta kaivalya, total withdrawal from the worldly things without any effort, and bhuta pruthaktvani, and thus one is in the midst of the world and yet not touched by the world. This starts happening when we start living in awareness. The seeker thus has to start working on his mind consciously, and various techniques are given like this. In this manner, evam deha shuddhi, bhuta shuddhi, pranayam, pratyahar, dharana, dhyan, samadhi bihi, ya tattva rupa, siddhir bhavati, sa moha avaranad, natu tattva vidnyanad, ityaha. Now be attentive, it's the most important sutra, sixth sutra, moha varanad siddhi. This is one of the most difficult thing for every seeker. When you thus start working on your mind, your life becomes something decent. Many hidden potentialities, many hidden qualities called as siddhis, they start surfacing. And we get caught up in those siddhis. Therefore it is said, moha avarnat, natu tattva jnanat. See friends, this is very subtle point. You can see one example I'll give. One of my Sindhi friend, I went to their house for food. And that amma, only two old fellows. So that amma said, Swamiji, I'll take a 10-15 minutes. Never mind, I'll read newspaper. The husband said, oldie one. He said, no, Swamiji, I'll get a harmonium. I said, look here, I don't play that, you know, hame to loot liya, I am not interested. Useless. I am not interested in harmonia. I believe in harmony, not harmonium. But he said, no, Swamiji, I'll bring it. No, I had to take food in his house, what can I do? He brought it. Kept it on the dining table. I said, look here, I don't know how to play. He said, no, Swamiji, I am going to play. I said, my God. And then he said, I have recently started learning. And now I can play Sare Gamapa. And in that excitement, he undone that, air pumping ladder. And he started and no sound coming. He asked his wife, kya ho gaya isko? This is old age. For everything they want to ask the wife. Ye kapde pehnu kya? Nahi, waisi jao. It's a great fun to watch the old people. They're non-stop fighting with each other, but they can't live without each other. See? Their presence is an obstacle and their absence is a calamity. See? It's a great fun. So, he said, kya ho gaya isko? What happened? He said, I don't know your dabba, throw it away. Every day morning you start pa pa pa. She was not interested. Then I said, Mahatmaji, this locks you are not opened, you have to put them. Oh, I forgot. And excitement, he pulled so much, they came in his hand. With all that, then he started. Sa re ga. Now imagine this useless thing one person learns, wants to exhibit. Is it not? You people have big, big houses and nobody to live in. Then what you do? You have to have party so that people can see your house. And all houses have got the same bathrooms, same toilets, nothing new in that. Once I was in Australia and one Punjabi gentleman, he took me to his house. He never knew me. So he started telling Swamiji, here we have got everything automatic. And he started. He said, now see, it was raining. He said, no, I am not starting anything, but the wipers will automatically start. And the speed of the wiper is automatically controlled. It's very good. And then when we reach home, he said, now see, that garage door will automatically open. Automatically open. Then I went to wash my hands. He said, there is no tap here. Simply put your hand like this thing. Water will come automatically. Then he took me to the toilet. He said, here we don't have to flush. It comes only by sensor. It comes automatically flush. I said, may I ask you some question? Yes. He said, when you sit here, it automatically happens. What do you have to do? automatic. When small little things we have, don't we like to exhibit to everybody? And if we have the various siddhis which are not common among the people, do you think such a person will keep quiet? See, friends, it is very clearly to be understood. Therefore, Bhagavan Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, I really revere him for this particular advice he gave to all the seekers. A seeker should never cease to be a seeker throughout life. Don't become a guru. Don't start teaching the world. See, friends. Otherwise, you start blessing. Like many people, Swamiji, Ashirvad karo. I said, I don't know Ashirvad. Then what Love. Love does not create any barrier of age, superiority or inferiority. When I bless, I accepted I am superior than you, you are inferior. See, friends. Therefore, here it is said, this moha avaranat siddhi, moha avaranat. So, whenever the siddhis come, they are the expression of delusion. Don't get carried away by that. And this is told in our Puranic stories in different way. Everything is told the same thing, but story form. Like when Lord Shiva was doing tapasya, and then our Indra Bhagwan, he sent the Madan Kumar and party orchestra. And then that Madan Kumar went with his, you know, those flowery arrows and bow, and he wanted to create a desire and in the mind of Bhagwan and Shiva. And then he thought, I will be able to achieve this. And Lord Shiva simply opened his eyes. And with the third eye, that Kama was burnt. He became Ananga, formless. See, friends. So all these things are, when you are progressing on a spiritual path, there will be millions of temptations in the form of siddhis that will come to you. Therefore, it is moha avaranam. It is not the spiritual progress, but it is an obstacle on the spiritual path. Tadaha, therefore, it is said, moha jayat ananta bhoga sahaj vidya jayaha. And if we are able to transcend the impact of these siddhis, this is the seventh sutra, if we are able to transcend these siddhis, we do not use them, we do not talk about them, and we don't have to talk or tell anybody about our spiritual practice. Lead your life in this world as the most unclaimed ordinary person. We don't have to be someone extraordinary. No, I get up early in the morning, 4 o'clock. How much time you get up? I get 10 o'clock. I get up 4 o'clock in the morning and then again I go to sleep. See, no need. One technique I'll tell you. Try this. This technique I've been telling every talk, everywhere. It's the most simple technique. First, before you talk to anybody on any topic, ask a question to yourself. Is it necessary to talk? 99% you will get a reply, no need. You don't have to follow Mounam. It will happen. Most of the time we talk when it is not required. And what we talk? About our past. When I was there in Badrinath, we didn't ask you, but I want to tell you. See? And once this habit of talking about our past comes, then it is an urge like a vomit. When the vomition comes, and finally comes out, in the same manner. I should not say, but you know, our neighbor's daughter-in-law is better than our daughter-in-law. Are Maharani, when you know you should not say, why don't you keep your mouth shut? See, friends, try. Before we talk to anybody on any topic, ask this question, is it necessary to talk? But if we have to talk about politics, which is illusion, talk about weather, it is always changing. Talk about that. Talk about what must be the depth of the ocean, maximum depth. Can somebody go there? And there those fish or whatever they are living, how they must be carrying the burden of such a thick wall of water on their body. Are they not crushed behind it? Because when we go below the, when you talk like this, other person is not interested, you don't get seen or merit. Time pass ho gaya. One of the simple technique of controlling mind. Second technique is this one. Whenever you are all by yourself, don't talk to yourself. See, one funny thing about Yoga Shastra, I'll tell you. Yoga is defined as Yoga ha chitta vritti nirodha. But till date, they have not defined what is the meaning of controlling the thoughts. Friends, like we come out of the house after putting on clothes, we don't come out of the house naked, is it not? Exactly the same way. Thoughts do not come out of the mind without the clothing of words. Without words, try to think. You cannot. So if you want to really control your mind, stop talking to yourself. One of the most efficient method. And this can be practiced anywhere, anytime. But then where should we start? On commode. This is commode yoga. See, when you sit down there, don't talk till the things are over. See. When you practice this, not talking to yourself, you will never like to talk to others also. See, friends. So, moha jayat, when we thus conquer our mind, these moha, the delusion, the siddhis do not infect us, then ananta bhogat, then one is able to experience the being without becoming. Sahaja vidya is effortless being. On the spiritual path, knowing is being. In the material world, knowing is not being. Therefore, when these various kinds of siddhis are no more a burden for us, we just discard them. There is a story in the life of a great master. His name was Tukaram Maharaj. When he was doing his kirtan bhajan, Riddhi Siddhi came and told, Narayana has sent us to you. Please ask what you want. We will bless you. He said, I don't want anything. Go. He said, no, don't send me back. They will, God, Lord will punish me. That is my job to give you something. But I don't want anything. So they were saying, what to do. Then he being a devotee, he had compassion for them. He said, okay, you will be punished because of me. Then I will ask you something. Give me that. What is that? When you go back, don't come again. See how, friends, beautiful it is. And when a seeker has thus attained, then, evam ayam asadita sahaja vidyaha, he who has done abiding in his absolute being, then jagrat dvitiya karaha, then he is living in a totally different experience. Unlike us. Our experience is, duality is experienced to be real. He is functioning through the duality without creating the loss of the non-duality. See, the example is, in our body level, things are different. Teeth and tongue is different. But there is no biasness towards each one of them. So when the tongue is bitten by the teeth, there is no punishment for the teeth. And when the tongue goes and digs between the teeth, there is no appreciation. Because although there are differences, there is no differentiation on account of the differences, because the experience is in and through all the differences, there is one common denominator. He is living in this experience. Therefore, jagrat dvitiya karaha, he has this experience that he is the one on whom everything is appearing, like the waves appear on the ocean and ocean appears on the water. Normally we ask a question. I was going from Miami to Bahama Islands by cruise. So I was standing near the deck, evening time, and looking out. My friend asked me, Swamiji, how much deep must be the water here, can you imagine? I said, I don't answer wrong questions. He said, what is the wrong question? I said, there is no water in the ocean. Ocean is in the water. He said, Swamiji, please. See, whether water is in the ocean or ocean is in the water. He said, I am confused. I will not ask you anything now. In the same manner, we are not in the world is in me. This is the experience of this wise man. And with this experience, how he lives is the next topic. We'll take it tomorrow. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.